Moments of Inspiration, brought to you by the Presbyterian Church of Trinidad and Tobago. It is our prayer that this outreach program inspires you to start this new day with Almighty God, who has granted you the gift of today.
Good morning, friends, and welcome to Moments of Inspiration. I'm Reverend Joy Abdul-Mohan of the Point Fortin, Cedrus Pastoral Region, with the Presbyterian Church of Trinidad and Tobago. And I truly feel blessed to be leading you in today's devotion. Thank you for choosing to start this day with each one of us in worship and praise, in prayer, and the reading and proclamation of the Word of God. As we journey through this Lenten season, we are reminded time and time again of the need for prayer and fasting, forgiveness and repentance. But in the midst of all that self-reflection, we must also be mindful of the vast nature of God's amazing grace. As we explore this theme of grace today, I invite you to bow your heads with me for a word of prayer. Let us pray. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, Creator and Sustainer of our lives, the one who reigns over all things in your wisdom, in your love, in your power, we humble ourselves in your presence, and we, O God, praise you for your grace and truth revealed to us through your Son, Jesus Christ. Grant us the help of your Holy Spirit, we beseech thee, O God, that in prayer and praise we may worship you in the beauty of holiness, in spirit and in truth. Lord, you have made us for yourself, and you have called us into your fellowship. Forgive us if we have displeased you in body, soul, and spirit, in thoughts, words, and deeds. Put within us a clean heart and a right spirit, and grant us your grace, for Christ's sake. Amen. This morning, we are pleased to welcome Miss Caroline Pargassingh-Paria of the Aramalaya Pastoral Region. She is both an accomplished vocalist as well as violinist. She blesses us with both gifts today. Firstly, with her voice, with the reflective song, In This Hour.
Instead of wrath, in this precious hour, I
Thank you very much, Caroline, for sharing in worship with us today. Let us now prepare our hearts for the reading of God's word, which comes to us from 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 1 to 10. Let us hear the word of God. It is necessary to boast, nothing to be gained by it. But I will go on to visions and revelations of the Lord. I know a person in Christ who for 14 years ago was caught up in the third heaven. Whether in the body or out of the body, I do not know. God knows. And I know that such a person, whether in the body or out of the body, I do not know. God knows, was caught up into paradise and heard things that are not to be told, that no mortal is permitted to repeat. On behalf of such a one, I will boast. But on my own behalf, I will not boast, except of my weaknesses. But if I wish to boast, I will not be a fool, for I will be speaking the truth. But I refrain from it so that no one may think better of me than what is seen in me or heard from me, even considering the exceptional character of the revelations. Therefore, to keep me from being too elated, a thorn was given me in the flesh, a messenger of Satan to torment me, to keep me from being too elated. 3 times I appealed to the Lord about this, that it would leave me. But he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. So I will boast all the more gladly of my weaknesses, so that the power of Christ may dwell in me. Therefore, I am content with weaknesses, insults, hardships, persecutions, and calamities for the sake of Christ. For whenever I am weak, then I am strong. This is the word of God. Thanks be to God for his word. Amen. We hear from Caroline once more as she leads us with the song, In the Shadow of Your Wings. Today, she's accompanied by Mr. Kevin Ragbir of the Susmachar Presbyterian Church.
I'm
Thank you very much, Caroline, for that beautiful rendition. My dear sisters and brothers, our viewing audience, as we continue our Lenten journey, we are reminded of the sufficiency of God's grace in every part of our life. Our newspapers are filled with bad news as we listen to news reporters on television relating the tragic events happening around the world. We can easily become fatigued and despondent with the tragedy of what is taking place. Our text from 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 1 to 10, contains some good news for us this morning. Therefore, you, our viewing audience, are invited this morning to meditate with me on the theme of grace. Let us pray. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of all our hearts here be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer, for Christ's sake. Amen. Grace is at the foundation of Christianity. From a biblical and theological standpoint, grace is unmerited divine assistance given to humans for their regeneration or sanctification. In other words, it is God's unmerited favor, that which we do not deserve but yet receive. When we look at the context of 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 1 to 10, we are reminded of the Apostle Paul's spiritual journey of transformation. Here we find Paul is plagued by a physical ailment, a thorn in the flesh that will not go away. Paul says that he sought the Lord three times to remove this affliction, but God refused. God did not take the thing away, but instead give Paul strength to bear it. That is how God works. God does not spare us things, but makes us able to conquer them. To Paul came the promise and the reality of the all-sufficient grace. For Paul, God's grace was sufficient for physical weariness, physical pain, as well as opposition. All his life, Paul was up against it, and all his life he never gave in. No amount of opposition could break him or make him turn back or turn away from God. That was the work of the all-sufficient grace of Almighty God. Friends, God's grace made Paul able to face slander, as this letter shows. The all-sufficient grace made Paul care not what men or women thought of him to be, but what God knew him to be. It is by God's grace that we draw every breath. When we put our confidence in this flesh alone, we are destined for failure, for it is corrupt. God wants us to trust in God. The power of God is made available to you and to me. If we are struggling this morning with the issues of life, God's power is made available because God's grace is sufficient. Verse 9 reminds us, "My grace is sufficient for you, for power is made perfect in weakness. So I will boast all the more gladly of my weaknesses, so that the power of Christ may dwell in me." I like this verse because it reminds me that my weakness is a natural part of who I am and who God made me to be, that is, human. When I am too weak to do what needs to be done, then God's power is made perfect in my life. I am forced to rely on God. I ought not to depend on my strength because that could never save me or transform me. That is why God's grace is so important. While studying in the United States of America in the early 90s, I was introduced to a true story that inspired me to get involved in prison ministry. Nicky Cruz was the leader of the toughest gang in New York City in the 1950s. Cruz's parents were members of the satanic movement that abused him brutally. So he grew up as a hardened man, void of love and full of hate. He said, "I wanted to do to others what my mother did to me. I used to feel good when I hurt some people, but privately, Cruz didn't feel good. Privately, he said, when I was alone, I was there twisting and fighting. I felt so lost. Only two people saw the desperate condition of Nikki's heart. One was a psychologist who told him, there's a dark side in your life that nobody can penetrate. Nikki Cruz, you are walking straight to jail, the electric chair and hell. There's no hope for you. But then the other was a preacher called David Wilkerson. He risked his life to tell Nikki Cruz there was hope. I heard his voice, says Cruz. God has the power to change your life. But Cruz started to curse aloud. He even spat on the face of Wilkerson. He also hit him. I told him, I don't believe in what you say and you get out of here. Cruz never expected that this preacher would ever, ever want to help him. And so the preacher replied, you could cut me up into 1,000 pieces and lay them in the street, but every piece will still love you. And then Cruz says, it did damage to me, good damage in my brain and in my heart. I began to question, and for 2 weeks I could not sleep thinking about love. Cruz and his gang showed up at one of Wilkerson's rallies. One by one, they gave their lives to Christ. It was the crucifixion, Jesus' death on the cross. It was that grabbed Cruz's attention. He said, I was choked up with pain and my eyes were fighting and tears became to come down and more tears and I was fighting and then I surrendered. I let Jesus hug me and I let my head rest on his chest. I said, I am sorry. Forgive me. For the first time, I told somebody, I love you. The love Cruz got in return radically changed his life. When had he opened his eyes and got a new heart? It was when he experienced the regeneration of Almighty God. And he said, I am a child of God. This true story was dramatized in a classic book, The Cross and the Switchblade. Many of us must have heard about it before. Friends, in Trinidad and Tobago, we have our own true stories of conversion, like Cruz, this former gang leader. To name one of our own, reformed prisoner, Wayne Chance, founder of Vision on Mission. But we need to hear more positive stories like these. We as religious leaders, social workers, politicians, need to believe in God's sufficient grace to transform lives. I do not have the answers, but we need to partner with all stakeholders and institutions, community groups, to honestly find ways to deal with and stop the acts of violence perpetrated upon the weak and gullible in our country. Oh, how I pray that gang leaders and drug traffickers can be inspired by the conversion of Nikki Cruz and our own Wayne Chance. And many other men and women whose lives have been transformed by the grace of Almighty God. We can't outsin God's grace. We may have as many sins as sands on the beaches or stars in the sky or gallons of water in the ocean, but God's grace exceeds our sin. You may say, but you don't understand. I have abused my family. I have stolen. I have murdered. Listen to this, friends. Where sin abounds, grace abounds all the more. It does not matter where God places each one of us and how. That is rather for God to consider than for you or for me. God gives grace. And in the most difficult times, God's grace is sufficient. So if God places each one of us in great perplexity, God will give us much guidance. In positions of great difficulty, much grace. In circumstances of great pressure and trial, much strength. Hear God's word today, my friends. My grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, one Almighty God. Amen. Friends, for this period of Lent, we here at Moments of Inspiration have chosen to highlight the issue of violence that plagues our society. Violence touches all persons, our men, women, youth, and unfortunately, even our most vulnerable, our children. I now invite our National Youth Coordinator, Mrs. Simone Singh Saga, to share with us some of these community movements.
A most pleasant and joyous day to you viewers. I do hope that this morning's devotions have enriched your hearts. We focus our attention on a community moment dedicated to violence against children. Now children are, for me, the powerhouse of absolute joy. They say the darndest things, do the funniest things, love without borders, ask questions with intense curiosity, have pure outlooks on life that make them forgive, forget, and form friendships easily. Now I want you to picture a child that you know, a boy or a girl, a relative, a neighbor, a student even. Can you recall every word or action or facial expression or touch that you would have had with this child? You see, my friends, in this world that we live in today, we need to be more vigilant about how we treat with children. God gave us children for the continuation of life and as blessings in our lives. Every single child that we come in contact with is a vessel of potential and positivity that we must help build and develop. Too often, our news carries stories of abuse, violence, abductions, and even the death of many children in our country. We read time and time again of the increase in the number of orphans in the war-torn parts of the world. These violent acts are committed against children by adults. Yes, by the very same persons into whose care God entrusted these vulnerable, innocent beings. And then we wonder, how is it that bullying and fighting, cursing and disrespect is being brewed in our society? And I believe we must question ourselves and how we, as adults, treat with children. We must be aware of every single word and action we impress upon the minds of the little ones around us. They are hurt and violated when we turn away from them in anger, when we ignore their pleas for help, when we encourage them to be involved in activities they rather sit out. So let us all, together, as one, strive more diligently to listen more, safeguard more, teach more, and love more all the children in our world. Red and yellow, black and white, they are precious in his sight. In this light, the Board of Christian Education of the Presbyterian Church of Trinidad and Tobago invites children everywhere for a day of fun, faith, and friends at their National Sunday School Rally, taking place at the Naparima College Auditorium. Come out on Saturday, 8th April from 8:30 a.m. and experience an uplifting and joyful environment for the children. Thank you all, and see you there. Back to you, Rev.
Thank you, Simone. And now I invite you to bow your heads with me in prayer as we lift this nation to the Lord. Let us pray. Almighty God, we come boldly to your throne of grace and mercy, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in times of need. God, you showed us your love in Jesus, your Son. We recognize that you love all people and you forget none. And as we intercede for all your children today, we pray for all whom we love and all upon whom we bestow your watchful care, for all we have been blessed by, and all those who have blessed us with kindness, led us with patience, and restored us by their sympathy and help. We pray for all who have wished or done us wrong, that you would turn their hearts to penitence and ours to blessing, for all prisoners and captives and all who suffer oppression and those who have been violated by the hands of those who do not respect human life. Lord, may you intervene in the lives of those who plan evil and transform their hearts and minds, teaching them how to love and respect life, leading them to a better way of life. We pray, O God, for those who bear the cross of suffering, the sick in body and in mind, and all those who are troubled by the suffering of those they love, all those who are visited by worldly loss, that in the dark and cloudy day they may find peace and grace. Bless our country and all people everywhere. Grant us grace to choose right from wrong, light over darkness, hope over despair, love over hatred, peace, O God, over war, and remind us that we are your sons and daughters. Guide us throughout this Lenten season to be a true reflection of Christ in thoughts, words, and deeds, and grant us your grace, which is sufficient for us, for Christ's sake. Amen. Friends, we have come to the end of our devotions. If you have missed any of our previous episodes, you can find them on our YouTube channel, Presbyterian Church, Trinidad and Tobago. For any further information, we may be contacted via our website, www.pctt.org.tt. As we journey through this Lenten season, you're welcome to worship with us at any Presbyterian church near to your home every Sunday morning, and for our midweek Lenten services. Thank you for choosing to start this new day with us in devotion and praise to Almighty God in Christ our Lord. I now leave you with today's moment of inspiration. My grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness.